Moore and Childers, tonight at 10.
This is Pete Cannell. This is a Southern Pacific rattlesnake, fully loaded with poison. And this is me getting out of the way.
Yourself. It's a dangerous demonstration, and there's more, much more to come.
Tonight, you'll see the dramatic conclusion of our story of sharks and one woman's courage. An athletic young man who has an amazing jogging partner. You'll meet some wonderful dogs who are trained to hear for the deaf. Raging controversy over California's cunning little sea otters. And join us for the hilarious Calaveras frog jumping jubilee.
The fantastic animals. The funny, the fabulous, the frightening. You'll see them all tonight on Those Amazing Animals.
Back in 1975, I made a film using a 75 Ford LTD. This is my 1980 LTD.
Quite a contrast, believe me.
Outside, much leaner, smaller. It's roomier inside, and so comfortable. And more surprises, over 50% better estimated gas mileage with an automatic overdrive option you can't find on competitive American-built cars. See the 1980 LTD soon. You'll be impressed by what Ford has done to make this car act a lot smaller.
You're feeling good about yourself. You're drinking Diet Pepsi Cola with just one calorie and that great honest to Pepsi taste. And it shows in the way you look, the way you feel, and in everything you do.
Diet Pepsi. One small calorie, one great taste.
Burgess Meredith. And please welcome my co-hosts, Jim Stafford, Priscilla Presley.
There's one animal who enjoys the specific title of man's best friend.
Dogs have filled all kinds of occupations, from finding lost children, to herding sheep, to guiding the sightless.
And tonight, a story about a brand new way in which dogs can help the handicapped.
On the outskirts of Denver is a kennel where Agnes McGrath is training dogs to hear for the deaf.
All of our dogs come from shelters. They're unwanted dogs. And we go in the shelter, check the teeth, to judge the age of the dog. We're looking for dogs between 6 months and a year of age. We're looking for temperament. A dog that likes people, you can train to do just about anything. And as soon as we get that dog home with us, we do complete blood studies, We spay or neuter the animal, and so we know when we deliver the dog that we're delivering a healthy animal that will live a long life. Find a lot of good dogs at a shelter. When we first pick a dog out of a shelter and bring it here, we use three trainers. Two of the trainers have leashes on the dog. It is pattern training the dog to go to the door so he cannot possibly make a mistake. He's being guided to the door and back for the knocks. Many young deaf couples will request that we train a dog for a baby crying. The deaf obviously cannot hear their babies when they cry at night, and many of them may sleep with their baby and keep one hand on it so that they can feel it. So you can understand why they would want a dog trained for baby cry. Many of the deaf have systems called a TTY, that's a telephone telegraphic system. It works with a telephone. Telephone rings, and when they answer it, they hook it up to an acoustic coupler, and then they can type their messages between deaf households. It's comparatively expensive, but it is a way of communicating between the deaf households. It's so hard for a hearing person to put themselves in the place of someone that's deaf. For instance, you hear when you drop your keys. You hear when you drop your billfold. And when we have a request like that to train a dog to pick up something they've dropped, yes, we will do that. There are 500,000 blind in the United States. What they have is a visible handicap. You can see a blind person go down the street, but there are 2.4 million deaf, that's nearly five times as many, profoundly deaf in the United States. They have an invisible handicap.
Hi.
Hi, Spring.
Agnes visits a young wife with a trained dog named Spring and checks on his progress. One of the problems is that Spring does not react correctly when someone knocks at the door. Agnes will reinforce Spring's training.
You will need to work on the door with the leash.
Once I met the deaf and started working with the deaf, I was hooked completely. The lift that it gives a trainer to see the difference it makes in these people's lives is fantastic.
Good dog. Okay.
Look, Sheik, I know you can talk up a storm. How about saying those amazing animals? Can you say that? Those amazing?
Lots of lecture.
It just takes a little patience. You know, isn't it funny whether it's a bird like Sheik or any other animal, they can become so much a part of us that our lives start to revolve around them.
This is Joe Carvalho of San Jose, California. And here comes his jogging partner, Fifi.
Macaw. Joe first started training her to fly through a hula hoop.
Come on, Fifi.
As Joe went farther and farther down the block with the hoop, Fifi got impatient and started flying alongside. And soon he had an early morning friend.
Come on. That a girl. Okay, put it inside the mailbox. Turn around. Gotta get comfortable, huh? All the way in there. Atta girl. Okay, come on back, Fifi. Come on, hurry up. We're gonna be late for work. Atta girl. Good girl. Let's go. That's my girl.
Joe has 30 exotic birds. He's trained all of them himself. Beyond the personal pleasure he gets from them, they've become an important part of his business.
I said no fighting.
This is Joe's car wash. Until 5 years ago, business was really slow. Then, Joe brought one of his birds here to entertain the customers. And pretty soon, business was booming.
So So Joe got more birds and trained all of them. And the customers just keep coming back.
Is the car sprayed today, sir?
Yes.
Okay, be $4. Fifi, can give me the money? That a girl. Okay, bring it back to Dad. Come on, snap it up. Come on. That a girl. Okay, that's a $5 bill. You watch, we put it inside the register. Okay, give him a one back. Okay, just fly back to him. That a girl. Just take it from her. She's very friendly. Okay, Fifi, come on back. That's a girl. Okay, thank you. Hi, Keto. How you doing? How are you? Polly wants a cracker, huh? Okay. There you go. Will sunflower seed do? Hi, Ashley.
Hi.
Hi. Hello, honey.
Hello, honey.
Hi.
Hello, honey.
Sing me rock-a-bye, baby. Humpty Dumpty. How about a shake? Nice to meet you. No, you have to stay there. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
We thought you'd enjoy meeting Joe Carvalho and some of his fine feathered friends in person. And here they are.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, buddy. That's my boy. Okay. I'd like to introduce my good buddy here. This is Sheik. Sheik, can you say hello to everybody?
Hello.
That a boy. Sheik's a great little impersonator. He liked to do a couple imitations for you. His favorite one is an American eagle doing a pose. Sheik, can you do a big eagle? That a boy. That's a big American eagle. There's a drunk one. Okay. His next one is a vicious guard dog barking at an intruder. Sheik, can you bark? Would you believe a killer chihuahua? Okay, Sheik. Throw everybody out there a big kiss. Atta boy. Try to do that without lips. Okay, Sheik, would you like to play a little basketball for everybody? You would. Now, he's a very talented basketball player. He comes equipped with his own basketball court right here. Okay, Sheik, I got your little ball right there. It's in play. Show him your stuff. Now, watch this, Sheik. You're going to show him your fancy footwork? Get his beak stuck in the... There we go. How's that, huh?
Very.
All right. He's going for a layup. It's a slam dunk.
That's amazing. But where's Fifi?
Fifi, well, you know, she's a little leery about airplanes, so she decided to fly in herself. She should be in right about now. Fifi, here she comes. That's my girl.
Oh.
Good girl. All right. Thank you. Now, this is Fifi. Now, she's been working on a little magic trick. We have a little volunteer that's going to help me with this one. It's a little cutie pie there. Okay, you got your dollar bill? You do? Okay, now Fifi's going to do a little disappearing act. Isn't that right? Okay, see the money over there? Show her your stuff. Okay, just hand her the money. Okay, Fifi, hurry up back before she gets wise. That our girl. What? You want your money back, huh? It's disappeared. You don't believe that. Please, oh, can't. Fifi, she won't let us have it. Can you take it back to her right over there? That's my girl. Here she comes. There you go. Don't mind the little holes. All right. Thank you.
But now, you were working on another trick, and we have Priscilla and we have Jim in the audience to help you out. You want to try it?
Sure, we'll give it a try.
Never done it here.
We've got our volunteers all set. Okay, Fifi, they're waiting for you. Show them your stuff. Okay, Fifi, get set. You ready? Let's go. Oh. That a girl. Good girl. All right. Woo.
Very good. Now, she... See, can you top that, huh?
Bye-bye.
Whether you like being scared silly or like having a good laugh, we have all that and more in store for you.
A
close encounter with some of the deadliest snakes in America.
Fun with frogs, Calavera style. Dangerous Sharks with Valerie Taylor, part two.
In just a moment, we'll be back with all those amazing animals.
This year, I'm the entertainment committee, and this is the entertainment. So I got batteries that'll last. Duracell.
Tests prove after just a few hours, regular carbon batteries wear out. But you can get up to four times more use from Duracell. Duracell batteries last longer.
Look, if the music stopped, so would the fun.
Duracell. The copper top battery. No regular battery looks like it.
Or lasts like it.
Now, for your headache, a brand new extra strength pain reliever. Unsurpassed strength with the two most powerful pain relievers you can buy. And a third ingredient that may make them work even harder. Announcing new extra strength Excedrin capsules. Nothing you can buy is stronger or works harder. In capsules or new tablets, new extra strength Excedrin. Headache relief that goes as far as it can go.
Pizza Hut, pizza to go. Take that hometown taste right home with you.
Hello, Pizza Hut. Our incredible pan pizza. A thin pizza, too? You bet. We got it and you can get it. Hot and ready to go.
Check your hometown yellow pages. Pizza Hut, pizza to go.
Monday at 8, 7 Central, you asked for them, and here they are, the best of That's Incredible. From ordinary people with some extraordinary stories to ghostly tales and medical miracles and to daredevils who go for it against unbeatable odds.
That's incredible.
Then football's back and ABC Sports is there when the favorite Texas Longhorns and their arch rivals, the Arkansas Razorbacks, kick off the first game of the season on NCAA football.
Tomorrow, starting at 8, 7 Central on ABC.
Little fellow busily grooming himself is a sea otter, a rare and beloved attraction on the Northern California coast. Who'd ever guess he's the focus of one of the hottest controversies in the Pacific?
Once California's sea otters were part of a great river of fur that stretched from Baja California to the tip of Alaska. But then came the fur hunters, and when the slaughter finally stopped, there were only 50 otters left in California.
That was in 1911. Today, there are almost 1,500. They are still threatened.
The otter's range sits right between two oil ports, and that scares the conservationists. But the otters are slowly eating their way down the coast, and that scares the shell fishermen. So while the otter goes happily about his business, tempers are rising on both sides.
We feel it would be very dangerous and premature to try to restrict the otters to a small section of the coast where they're in such grave peril from oil.
By the time that animal gets into your production areas, as far as the abalone beds go, you're going to be bankrupt or out of business.
The otter is an irrepressible acrobat, and he's one of the few animals that uses tools. Under his arm, he carries a flat rock for cracking open his meals, and a pointed one for knocking them off the rocks.
He's enthusiastic about anything that lives in a shell. This abalone would sell for $12 a pound. The 1,500 otters now in the colony eat about 3,500 tons of shellfish a year.
For now, the otters are protected by law, but fishermen want them controlled, and people like Bob Hardy of California's Fish and Game Department are caught in the middle.
Our primary responsibility is to protect all the wildlife in California, including the sea otter. When the otter population expands into a new area where there are rich shellfish resources, it utilizes those resources down to a point where man can no longer harvest any. And that's the essence of the controversy, in that the population is expanding and the shellfish resources are being lost.
This company, Seafood Specialties, stands to lose a lot. Owner Mike Wagner processes 130,000 pounds of abalone steaks a year, and abalone is getting harder to find.
The fact is that as the otter comes into an area in which we're harvesting shellfish, the production by the commercial fisherman or commercial diver is going to drastically drop. There's lots and lots of evidence to prove that. So the downside is that that industry goes out of business when the otter comes into the same area. You can't have them both. And it's not only the abalone. It's your urchin fishery, your lobster fishery, and your rock crab fishery. This one, of course, I'm concerned today about abalone.
Friends of the sea otter fear the colony won't expand fast enough to withstand human pressures. Their spokesperson, Carol Fulton, worries about oil spills and pollution, and now about the otter's fate in this controversy.
We continue to have otters that wash ashore that have been shot or bludgeoned or hit by a boat. So here's a species that is slowly recovering from near extinction. And just when it looks like it might be getting a toehold, people start yelling that it's got to be controlled. Think of all the problems that the sea otter has that nature designed for it to cope with. I really have trouble understanding all the problems that man is devising for the sea otter. We feel that the otter is often used as a scapegoat to distract from man's own overharvest and mismanagement of shell fisheries.
He eats all the time, and he does not have any distinction for limits or sizes.
The sea otter has a high metabolism because it's a small animal in cold ocean water. They don't eat just abalone. They eat over 40 different kinds of food.
When he is eating abalone, he eats between $200 and $300 worth of abalone per day. If we lost them all, they could be replaced from a stock out of Alaska.
Friends of the sea otter have been urging a transplant to establish another breeding colony of sea otters. You have to have an area where there's sufficient food supply, kelp beds, where you can control the human pressures and protect the otters. For this reason, one of the areas that is being explored is San Nicolas Island, one of the outermost of the Channel Islands off Santa Barbara.
Well, these people, like this lady right here, she's been in the industry some 20 years. If I lose San Nicolas, this lady and this plant and those fishermen are out of business. It's done.
The controversy will go along as long as this sea otter population is allowed to expand, because it's going to be entering new areas that fishermen are currently harvesting in. So the only time that the controversy can end is when a decision is made as where sea otter should be contained, or if they should be contained.
Time will tell if there's room in the ark for this little fella. For now, we wish him good luck.
We have our very own expert on some animals, especially spiders and snakes. That was the title of one of his hit songs. And tonight, we'll hear a brand new one he's written especially for those amazing animals. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jim Stafford.
Back in 1976, an athletic little critter set a new world's record of 20 feet, 3 inches, and just 3 hops. His name was E. Davy Crockett. He was a frog. Tonight we'd like to honor the annual Frog Jump Jubilee held in Angels Camp, California, dating back to the Gold Rush days. It was inspired by Mark Twain's American classic, The Celebrated Jumping Frog of Calaveras County.
Sliding like flapjack molasses with a hop and a hip hooray. Young folks, old folks, anyone can do it. Just find yourself a bullfrog, honey, hop to it. Can't tell who has the most fun, the frog or the folks, cause they both hop around till they darn near croak. On a Calaveras good time and huckleberry fun kind of frog hopping day. Hooray for a Calaveras good time and huckleberry fun kind of frog hopping day.
The rules specify that each frog is allowed 3 leaps. The distance is measured from the circular jumping pad to the end of the 3rd leap.
Nine foot six, Debbie.
Calaveras, good time and huckleberry fun kind of frog hopping day. Hooray for a Calaveras, good time and huckleberry fun kind of frog hopping day. Down to the river, look under a log and find your very own champagne frog. And set him on the starting line, you don't have to push unless, of course, you don't jump, and then you tap him on the tush. Sort of prompting is legal. There's the stoop and kiss, the hop and holler, the creepy crawl, and the fabulous froggy jump along. You want to learn to frog hop, don't go to school, just learn to love frogs. That's the very first rule. You can take a frog to dinner, he might be surprised. He'll flip the tip and check your soup for flies, if you know what I mean.
Snakes. We know more about them than almost any other snake in the world. They're also among the most feared and the deadliest. There is a colorful and unique organization of experts in Texas who spend their weekends teaching as many people as possible everything they should know about rattlesnakes. They call themselves the Heart of Texas Snake Handlers Club.
Hi, we'd like to welcome y'all to the Mason Rattlesnake Stampede. We're here to entertain and educate you for about the next 45 minutes. Whatever you see us doing in this pit, please do not try to attempt it yourself. There are little tricks about this whole deal, and we know most of them. We're going to try to show you what to do and what not to do with rattlesnakes. Again, I repeat, I cannot stress it enough. Do not attempt to do anything you see us doing in this pit. Show you, hopefully, that it is possible to walk away from without getting bit or without getting struck yet. If you go slow enough and careful enough, hopefully you can get out of there without getting struck or without getting bit. All right, give him a hand, folks. That's all I'm going to get for him.
The Texas snake handlers use every possible precaution to keep from being bitten by a rattlesnake. Recently, however, while their Amazing Animals episode was being filmed, their luck ran out, and the person who suffered the bite was club president Butch Heffelfinger.
Yeah, Butch got bit by a high striker. Butch was playing with him, turned around, walked away, and he got him right in the calf of the leg. They operated on his leg, cut his leg open about three different places to cut the rotten meat out. And it did affect the club, because Butch is the president of the club, and when you get a main man like that bit, it makes your chances all the more. You think, you know, he is supposed to be real good at this, and he got bit, and we're not near as good as he is, and think, well, maybe my turn is next.
Chief, if I drank this stuff.
How do you feel about snakes now?
Occupational hazard.
Ladies and gentlemen, he came through that rattlesnake bite with flying colors, and here's Butch Heffelfinger. How's the bite here, Butch?
Well, it hadn't yet. It's been about, I guess, 4 months now, and I've still got an open place on it.
Oh, jeez. Oh. Well, Butch, if you were face-to-face with a snake, what are one of the things you should not do?
First of all, you shouldn't panic. If you sudden movement, like running or anything like that, it'll attract the snake's attention, because they bite by, well, they have poor eyesight. They bite by some eyesight, but it's mainly about a movement, and they have what they call a Jacob's organ for their heat sensor.
How fast does the venom of the rattlesnake work?
It all depends on each individual's body chemistry. You may receive a bite of four drops and not do any harm to you at all, and I may receive a bite of one drop and it may drop me in my tracks.
Mm. Well, if you're bitten by a rattlesnake, should you try to cut the wound with a knife and suck the venom out like they usually say to do?
I would say definitely not.
No. Well, what happens?
Something like 30% of the people that get bit don't receive any poison. And they do all this cutting. They may cut a vein, artery, or ligament, something like that, and ruin their arm or leg.
Well, if you're completely alone and you're bitten by a rattlesnake with no one to help you, I mean, what should you do?
Again, remain calm. I didn't get any reactions to my snake, my last bite, for probably two and a half hours. They remain calm and get to some kind of medical attention or somebody that can get them to medical attention.
Jeez. Well, we've asked the club to demonstrate how they walk barefoot through a field of rattlesnakes, and I'm glad I'm up here.
Well, I guess I'm stuck here. But fortunately, I have James Wood to guide me through.
If possible, 95% of the time, that you can walk through the rattlesnake or walk away from him barefooted and get by with it. Slowly and carefully. You see how close... Oh, you got one crawling there. That is not a good sign. The tongue is flicking out. The tongue is a heat sensor. That finds out whether they want something to eat or not. And he's close enough now to Charlie to take a good bite. He's still crawling. The other handlers are watching him. That's why they're in there. There is no way we can keep Charlie from getting bit once. Hopefully, with the many handlers we have in there, we can keep him from getting bit twice. Like I said before, Charlie walking slowly and carefully. And I still don't like that one by his right foot. That sucker is just, he's upset. As I said, the heat from the lights has got him moving more than what we'd normally like to have him. Charlie, watch your left foot right behind you. He's there. And normally, they do not move this much, but that one back there is very active. All these snakes do have their fangs. They do have their venom. It is possible 95% of the time that you can walk through the rattlesnake or walk away from him barefooted and get by with it. All right, Charlie's eased through him one way, and he told me before that he's going to go turn around and go back through him. All right, he's going to go back through him. Now, y'all need to watch careful. I know sometimes it's hard to see with all the handlers in there, and I said, that's for Charlie's safety. Now, if you thought you saw him do something before, you watch this time. The foot right on top of the head, kick him out of the way. Oh, I didn't see that one. Pete said he don't want him. Now, what are you kicking him over there for? All right. Myself. Jerry said that was him you threw that sucker on. As I said, they come unwind. They do. They can bite at any time. Charlie's putting his feet right on top of him, kicking him back. Charlie, Pete said that one's in the wrong place. He don't care if you slide him, that's the place to slide him to. You are seven. Now you got two of them there. Both at one time, maybe. Easy. Oh. Okay, good. Yeah, this would give you heart failure. Just about got them all. Now you watch that one there on your right. He got his head pointed right straight towards you. And now the tongue is flicking out. Like I said, the tongue is a heat sensor. That's how they find something to eat. All right, folks, give him a hand. That's all he's going to get for it.
Built to get around. Really go to town. Looking good top to bottom.
Here comes Wrangler, and he's one tough customer, and he knows what he likes when he sees it.
We've got things you can be sure of, like a holiday parade. Roosters crowing, children growing, and the taste of Minute Maid.
You're sure of homemade pies, lullabies, picnics under sunny skies. And the
taste of Minute Maid.
The great taste of 100% pure Minute Maid orange juice is never going to change. And that you can be sure of.
Make sure of the taste. Make sure of the taste. Make it Minute Maid.
On All My Children, it's a fairy tale come true.
So stop worrying. Marrying the girl you love.
Someone could break the spell. A friend with a mysterious past, a bridegroom with a terrible secret, and a father who could disgrace them. Weekdays on All My Children.
Those Amazing Animals continues in a moment.
Arkansas tackles Texas tomorrow on the premiere of NCAA football on ABC.
Welcome to Wix Furniture's store-wide celebration sale.
We're celebrating the grand opening of our beautiful new store in Niles on Golf at Milwaukee Avenue. And there are store-wide savings for you at every Chicagoland Wix.
Everything is on sale, from complete room settings to the smallest accessory.
Come save at our grand opening store-wide sale happening now through Monday night, September 8th.
Quality home furnishings at prices you can afford.
That's Wix Furniture.
Now in Niles, too.
Jay Berry on sports tonight at 10.
Now, walking barefoot through a pit of rattlesnakes is a tough act to follow, but the members of the Heart of Texas Snake Handlers Club seem to enjoy that kind of challenge. So, James, the stage is yours. All yours. Take it.
All right, thank you. What you're about to see right now is something that has actually happened. People have been out camping and woke up and found a rattlesnake in their sleeping bag with them. I said, this is serious. People have actually found rattlesnakes in their sleeping bags, just one. But just to show you that we can get by doing this, hopefully, we're gonna put one or two, maybe three, in a sleeping bag with Shorty. All these snakes do have their fangs. They do have their venom. Oh, look at Larry, slap him on the nose. Get back in there. Larry's trying to train them right here, right quick. Get your nose back in there. When you're out there counting, if you would happen to find this, wake up and find a rattlesnake in there with you. Hopefully, you'll be camping with somebody else, and they will be there and can unzip the sleeping bag very slowly, lift it up slowly, and take a stick and drag the rattlesnake off of you. What we're showing you is in case you're there by yourself or your friend has gone fishing or whatever, and you find him in there, you feel him in there, we're going to show you that maybe it is possible to crawl out without getting bit. I think you got enough snakes in there. Why don't we go ahead and zip it up? Shorty, it's up to you. He's going to take it nice and slow and easy. Eat himself out of there. He's using his hands and his shoulders. He's straining. His head's shaking. He's sweating. And he just had a heart attack and died. No, wrong. He's still going. All right, the rule we have in our club is when you're doing this little number here, if you bring any rattlesnake out with you, you have to do the whole trick over again, head first. He's allowed to bring his butt buckle out. That's all right. Careful. He's easy. Wait, what are you guys doing?
I don't want him.
You don't want him?
Put him back.
Put him back on there. There you go. Oh. Shorty is already aged 10 years already in this 15 minutes. All right. That's it. He's doing it slow and easy. Careful. All right. He's just about out. 1 foot out. Give him a hand, folks. That's all he's going to get for it. All right. Now we're going to take you to the sleeping bag. Oh, wait a minute. I told these folks that this was fake. And just to prove it to them, dump the bag out and show them there's no snakes in there. They all left. Just dump it out there so they can see there's no snakes in there. Just, looky there.
Ladies and gentlemen, Butch Heffelfinger, James Wood, and the Heart of Texas Snake Handlers Club. Hey!
Sharks. Many are so-called man-eaters, but that description must be tempered by the fact that no man-eater depends entirely on human flesh. These are the deep-water blue sharks. They're always curious, sometimes placid, and sometimes dangerous.
Last week, we showed you the unexpected events leading to the frenzied attack of a shark, which slashed Valerie Taylor's leg so badly that 140 stitches were needed to close the wound.
An ordinary person wouldn't have risked another encounter with the same species of shark.
Valerie Taylor is not an ordinary person. She is determined, dedicated, and courageous. Only a few weeks later, with her cameraman husband Ron, she went back to the feeding grounds of the sharks.
On the 80-mile journey to the same waters where Val was attacked, the Taylors reflect on their lives.
Ron and I aren't scientists, and we've never made any claim to being scientific, but we have had to learn a great deal about sharks and their behavior because we find that working in the oceans, as we have over the last 25 years, we've come into contact with a lot of sharks, and
we specialize in the dramatic marine creatures, not only sharks, but manta rays and sea snakes, moray eels, stonefish, cone shells, giant clams, anything that captures the public's imagination.
You know, a coral polyp eating a fish, catching and eating a fish, is a very dramatic scene, but nobody sort of gets excited about coral polyps.
But everybody gets excited about sharks. That's what we're specialized on. And, of course, the most spectacular of all is the feeding habits, and that's what we were doing here. Valerie had some fish in her hand, and I was going to record with my moving camera the feeding habits of these sharks. But unfortunately, the shark started feeding on the...
wrong end.
This was the moment when, for only the second time in Val's career, and the first serious time, she was attacked.
And I'd say about 20 years we've been working with sharks. I suppose we've had a few close calls, but this is the first proper bite. And it wasn't even a great surprise. It was just a pain in the neck, a bother. And I reacted, I feel, in the correct way. If I'd struggled or pulled away, I could have lost that whole piece out of my leg, which would have been extremely nasty. But I got rid of the shark, it withdrew its teeth, and I simply swam back to the boat. They took off my wetsuit. They had to cut it off, actually, which was a shame because it was a brand new wetsuit, the best wetsuit I've ever had in my life, and I'd had it on for about 10 minutes, and it was all cut up. I was very, very unhappy about that.
It's amazing to look at the records and see that sharks really don't eat people. They bite and usually let go. It's on extremely rare occasions that sharks actually feed upon a human victim. And that's a little comforting to know that they're not man-eaters in the true sense. I call them man-biters.
It's going to be really nice to go in with a weapon instead of a fish. Be able to defend myself. The sharks don't seem to mind when you hit them with a fish, but if
you hit them with that, they'll take notice.
Yes, they'll treat me with a bit of respect.
The time has come for Val to go back in. On this expedition, she and Ron will try to tag the deepwater blues for identification and long-range tracking.
The Taylors are keenly aware that their tagging spears alone can't completely control the sharks. The attack on Val could happen again.
To attract the sharks, the Taylors have again put a lot of food in the water. More than 40 of the fast-swimming, obviously hungry blues have moved in.
The ocean's rougher this time. Val is determined to go in.
It begins smoothly, but it's obvious that both Val and Ron are more cautious than before.
They start the feeding, at the same time keeping their eyes on the movements of the sharks.
The sharks are in an attacking mood.
Some sharks over by being gentle, but with others, you gotta try to show them who's boss.
The technique is well known. When you hit a shark with an object, it will snap his jaws closed, rendering it harmless for a few seconds.
Now for the moment for which the expedition was planned, the tagging of the deep water blues. As predators, they play an important part in the life of the seas. With all that science has learned about sharks, feeding habits, their speed during an attack, how they home in on their prey, the force of their bite, no one's ever successfully tracked them in the broad expanse of the ocean. If some of these magnificent blues are caught in the future, we will learn more of their secrets, exactly where they go, what routes they follow, and what they need to survive.
For Val, as she comes back on board, it's a moment of personal triumph, of a job well done.
I can remember myself, a shy little girl, leaving all that she knew behind her to start a new life here in America. With my wonderful new family, I managed to make it through this period of adjustment. So I want to thank you, everyone, but most of all, thank you, Mom and Pop. I love you very much.
Shouldn't you trust your story to Kodak Film?
Plymouth challenges Toyota Corolla with a front-wheel drive Plymouth TC3. In an independent test, 50 people considering buying an import next time compared a TC3 to a Toyota Corolla Deluxe Sport Coupe for styling, features, driving ease, riding comfort. Based on this, they preferred the Plymouth TC3 to the Toyota overall by a score of 34 to 16.
Compare for yourself. The new Chrysler Corporation has the front-wheel drive cars to challenge the imports right now.
There really is a Kentucky Fried Chicken school.
Yep, today we're making the Colonel's original recipe.
What have you learned?
Fresh chicken makes the best chicken.
And that we use 11 herbs and spices.
Oh, but that's the Colonel's secret. And special pressure cooking.
So it's always tender and juicy.
Looks like you've learned to make great chicken.
Only way to serve our customers right.
It's so nice, nice to me. So good about me. So good about Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Get ready for a new night of comedy Wednesdays on ABC.
Taxi. Oh, I love Taxi.
Now hear this. Taxi and Soap report to Wednesday nights following Eight is Enough.
I ain't going.
Of course you're going.
Look here, you popsicle stick. We can do without your wooden delivery.
Wooden delivery.
Okay, that tears it, you little strip.
See you Wednesdays, Bert.
Taxi and Soap, a comedy combination you don't want to miss this fall on ABC.
Animals of all types are friends of the family to the talented young lady who's with us again this evening. She's been seen many times on The Tonight Show. And at the San Diego Zoo, she always fascinates the small fry. And that's exactly what she's going to do for us this evening. So welcome, Joan Embry.
We're going to look at a couple very interesting animals here tonight. And this one that's kind of squirming here in my hands is called an armadillo. And they come from the southern United States and range down into Mexico and South America. And as you can see, although they have a very soft belly, they have an extremely good armor on their back, and that helps to protect them. There are different types of armadillos according to the number of bands that they have, and the bands allow them to bend so that they can tuck their head up underneath themselves to protect themselves here. See how this one does? And when I hold it up, she'll actually tuck her head right in underneath her armor. These animals actually are very interesting because when they have babies, they usually have several identical twins. That means they have all boys or all girls, and they're identical in their chromosome structures. And they aren't dangerous at all. They can't bite you, and their defense to get away would be to run. And if they can't run away, what they'll do is dig with their sharp claws that you see here and actually burrow right underground. And their burrows are often used by other types of animals as well. Would you like to touch their armor? And just get a feel how hard that is and what a good protective device it is for that animal. Isn't that interesting? Now we're going to take off the armadillo. We're going to show you a really prehistoric looking animal. So we'll put the armadillo down here and we'll reach around. And let me hand two of you one of these animals. This is called a chameleon. They're from East Africa. If you want to pick one up, they're going to hold onto your finger much like they would a branch, because they are found in East Africa and they're arboreal, and that means they live in trees. Just let them crawl right up there onto your hand. Usually if you put your finger out, you'll notice that their feet are split. And that helps them for grasping onto the branches where they live. And they also have a prehensile tail. If you'll notice, they use their tail as they walk through that branch to hold on to the branch. And when they aren't using their tail, they curl it up very neatly in a tight little package so it doesn't get in their way. And these animals eat insects as well, and we want to show you here tonight how they eat. They have a tongue that's almost as long, actually is a little bit longer than their body. And when they watch this insect, you'll see that the eyes can move independently. The eyes will watch both forwards and back, so they can watch for predators at the same time they're watching for something to eat. Now, if you watch her very closely, she's gonna take that cricket with that extremely long tongue. Let's see, we'll give her one more whack at it here. Here it comes. So what do you think of those amazing animals?
Every week, we take a glimpse into our Amazing Animals Almanac. Well, some animals are so amazing that it's almost impossible to believe their bizarre lifestyles. And the remarkable story which you're about to see was filmed by wildlife cameraman Marty Stouffer.
Tunneling through this peaceful meadow is a tiny warrior who is the most ferocious creature in the animal world.
Enter the shrew. Approximately 2 inches long, he has a bite like a cobra, devours twice his own weight in food every day, and can deck any creature three times his size.
Basically, the shrew is an insect eater, but he'll never refuse dining on any animal small enough for him to overpower.
He is also particularly fond of nice, fat worms. In fact, that tender tidbit has led to this battle royal with a fellow shrew, also partial to worms.
Armed with needle-like teeth, the shrew's saliva contains a strange virulent poison which can kill any small enemy within 3 minutes.
The smaller the animal, the more food it needs to maintain its body heat and energy level. And if the shrew doesn't eat every 3 hours, it'll die.
The battle ends. To the victor, the spoil. Ounce for ounce, he's the toughest animal of them all.
Enough, in spite of all the shrew's ravenous eating habits, within a brief 15 months, he will die of old age.
Well, like they say, you can't live forever.
Sometimes you feel like a nut.
Sometimes you don't.
Almond or gut nut.
Mounds don't.
Sometimes you feel like a nut.
Yeah.
Sometimes you don't.
Ooh. Peter Paul, I'm enjoying Scott next.
Peter Paul, Mounds don't.
Because.
Sometimes you feel like a nut. Sometimes you don't.
We're gonna go Hawaiian.
Hawaiian Punch is the taste, the one and only taste.
That really goes Hawaiian.
Hawaiian Punch is more than just a cold drink. It's 7 natural tropical fruits come together with 10% fruit juice for the taste everybody loves.
Go Hawaiian, go Hawaiian.
The
there's an exciting new flavor from Hawaiian Punch. A new wild fruit punch. I'm just wild about the taste.
Really wild, Marie. New wild fruit punch from Hawaiian Punch.
There's a brief line in William Shakespeare's play Coriolanus that we'd do well to remember. Shakespeare wrote, "Nature teaches beasts to know their friends." Thank you.
We'd like to thank James Wood and the Heart of Texas Snake Handlers Club for being with us, and of course, Joe Carvalho with all his fine feathered friends.
Now, if you have a pet or you know someone with a pet who talks or sings or is trained to do something different and amazing, please send us a picture of the animal and a brief letter with all the facts.
Our address is Those Amazing Animals, Post Office Box 250012, Los Angeles, California, zip code 90025.
And don't forget to include your telephone number so we can reach you easier and faster.
Now, next week, we will be moving into our permanent time period at 7 o'clock Sunday evening.
We plan to celebrate that occasion with a special 90-minute edition of our program, including guest stars John Davidson, Fran Tarkington, and Kathy Lee Crosby of That's Incredible.
Be welcoming to our show a distinguished new member of our team, Captain Jacques Cousteau.
Until next week at 7 o'clock and our special 90-minute edition of Those Amazing Animals, good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.
This is David Hartman. AFL-CIO President Lane Kirkland talks about labor's role in the presidential election tomorrow on Good Morning America.
Tomorrow, a blind track star races to win on That's Incredible, a special request. 1 week from tonight at 7, 6 Central and Mountain, a special 90 minutes of excitement on Those Amazing Animals. Now stay tuned for Showdown, next on the ABC Sunday Night Movie.
An ABC News brief.